Okay, good morning everyone. I hope we're all invigorated by half an hour of more sleep so that we can learn about some presymplectic groupoids in Daniel's last mini course. Are we ready? Yes. Please.
Okay. Thank you. This, as the chairman said, this is the last lecture in which we will take a look at some structures that arise in connection with the standard form of Neumann algebras, and these structures resemble quite a lot the notion of presymplectic groupoid. I will start by briefly reminding you about the notations related to the standard form. So by script M, we denote, as usual, for Neumann algebra, it consists of bounded linear operators on the Hilbert space H. And what distinguishes for Neumann algebras from C-star algebras is that they possess a predual. So in other words, they are the dual space of another Banach space. And this predual can be identified as the set of all linear functionals on our algebra, that functionals that are continuous with respect to a weaker topology, weaker than the norm topology. We can define the positive cone in this predual space, namely as the set of all functionals in the predual that take positive values on the positive elements in our system, in our von Neumann algebra. So the positive elements in M are exactly the ones that can be written as X star X for some X in M. And two particularly important subsets of M are the set of all the lattice of projections, self-adjoint idempotents. And we call it a lattice because it has a natural order relation, and it is actually a complete lattice with respect to that order relation. And the set of all partial isometries, they are operators V, elements in V, V in M, for which V star V and VV star are projections. In the case of when M is the set of all bounded operators, as I said before, an operator is a partial isometry if and only if it is an isometry on the orthogonal complement of its kernel. In other words, we can think of a partial isometry as really an isometry defined, however, only on a closed subspace of our Hilbert space. So whenever we have such an isometry from a subspace to another subspace, onto another subspace, we can extend it by zero on the orthogonal complement of the domain, and we obtain a bounded linear operator on the whole space. So this again explains why we call them partial isometries. A standard von Neumann algebra meant an algebra that has a cyclic separating vector, and using such, there exist many such. I mean, if it has one cyclic separating vector, it has many of them. And using each one, one can define several structures. The most important for the present lecture are an antilinear isometry of the Hilbert space into its, onto itself, antilinear isometry that is equal to its own inverse. So we can think of it as a kind of complex conjugation on our Hilbert space. And moreover, there is a closed convex and pointed cone. So both J and P depend on selecting a cyclic separating vector, but we don't indicate this vector since we can do the same for any of them and we obtain what we need. So for every standard algebra, we have a conjugation and a convex cone, and they have the following properties. The map that takes an element in the algebra to JXJ takes the algebra to its commutant. This map from X to JXJ is like taking a matrix and taking the complex conjugates of its entries. So this is preserves everything, multiplication and so on, except that it is antilinear. In the case when an element belongs to the algebra and to its commutant, this mapping JXJ agrees with the Hilbert space adjoint. Moreover, J applied on a vector in our cone is always the identity. And I will perhaps sometimes say that this is the positive cone. It should be considered as a kind of positive cone. And then this is this property shows that, as we could expect, the conjugation of a positive complex conjugation of a positive vector is again the same vector. And moreover, a property that is quite important but maybe more implicit at this point is that if we take an arbitrary element in M, then and we form X and its corresponding element in the commutant, we denote it by little j of X, then X, j of X preserves this cone, the positive cone. In fact, the cone was defined as in the following way. We selected a cyclic separating vector, we denoted it by X I naught at that point. And then we consider the set of all x, j of x applied to that fixed vector, and then we took the closure. It was not obvious, but it is true that it is a convex cone. So what we have here is a product of two commuting operators. X belongs to the algebra, and j of x belongs to the commutant, belongs to the commutant by the first property. So we could say that a standard Feynman algebra is actually a quadruple formed from an algebra, a Hilbert space, a conjugation, and a positive cone in that Hilbert space, satisfying these conditions. In this setting, we can define what we call the expectation map from the Hilbert space to the positive cone of M. Namely, for every vector gamma in the Hilbert space H, we form this expression gamma scalar product with X applied to gamma. This expression in the right-hand side, regarded as a functional on X, so gamma is fixed, is a linear functional on X. And this is, so this is an element in the predual. Moreover, it is positive. So if X is of the form, let's say Y star Y, then Y star Y goes to the left-hand side and one can see that we obtain a positive value here. The name expectation comes from the motivation. The motivation for this name should be found in the quantum mechanics, where whenever we have a self-adjoint operator and we apply it to a vector, so a vector describes the state of a system, and when we apply and self-adjoint operator is like a measurement. And then when we form this expression is the value that we expect for the system in that state, the value of that quantity expressed by the operator in the corresponding state. This is just to explain why we call it an expectation. And especially since in this area, there is another notion of conditional expectation that is completely different from this. And the expectation map, once again, is a map from the Hilbert space to the positive cone of our algebra. And as I said in the first lecture, restricting this map to the positive cone, we obtain a homomorphism. This was the theorem due to Hagerup. It's a homomorphism. Here on the cone, we have the topology induced from the Hilbert space. And here on the positive cone in the predual, we have the norm topology. Okay, this should be in some sense regarded as a square root map. So we will see in a specific example when M is an algebra of the form L infinity of some Hilbert space, in the standard representation, this is a map that goes from, in some sense, from square integrable functions to absolutely integrable functions, from positive square integrable functions to absolutely integrable functions. So the natural map is back and forth is given by square and the square root. We will see this in a specific example. Using this homomorphism, one can we were able to speak about the polar decomposition of vectors in our Hilbert space. Namely, every vector can be uniquely written as the partial isometry applied to a positive vector. So here V sub gamma is an operator, modulus of gamma is an element in our cone. And there is a relation that between them, namely V sub gamma is isometry on a certain subspace. And that subspace is exactly the subspace obtained as by applying the commutant to modulus of gamma and then taking the closure. As I explained in the first lecture, if we form this operation, namely we apply the commutant to some vector and take the orthogonal projection onto this, we obtain an projection in the algebra itself, not in the commutant. So if we start from the commutant, we obtain a projection in the algebra. And if we have this homomorphism, in order to obtain the modulus of gamma, we do like this. We take any vector gamma, we move it, we consider its expectation, which will be a positive functional. And then the positive functional by this homomorphism comes from a unique positive vector. And that unique positive vector is just the modulus of gamma. So in some sense, the inverse of this homomorphism is actually a global cross-section for this continuous map. And by this global cross-section, we obtain the modulus of any element, any vector. Okay, in this setting, what we will do today will be to encode all this structure in a groupoid that resembles, that actually carries a structure resembling the presymplectic groupoid. So by the end of this week, of course, everybody knows what a groupoid is, but I will just to fix the notation, I will repeat the definition briefly. So we think of a groupoid as a set of a set of arrows endowed with a partial multiplication. Namely, we multiply only the composable pairs. It's possible to have arrows from one point to itself. And the composability means that the source of, for instance, gamma one is composable with gamma two because the source of gamma one is the target of gamma two. More rigorously, a groupoid is a small category, so the objects form a set, not just any category, whose morphisms are invertible. The set of unit elements or the objects of that category are denoted like this. The object inclusion map, so, which takes every object to its identity morphism, is epsilon. Source and target are denoted by S and T. The set of composable pairs is by the star and multiplication map by dot. And the inversion map will be denoted by iota. Briefly, we will denote a groupoid like this, two parallel arrows from the set of arrows to the set of objects. We say a groupoid is a Banachli groupoid if both J and both the total space and the set of objects are Banach manifolds, and the source and target are submersions. And the moreover, the multiplication and inversion are smooth. By submersion, we mean submersion of Banach manifolds. We mean submersion in the sense of Bourbaki, for instance. So not only that the differential at a point is surjective, but also that its kernel has a complement in the tangent space of the domain of definition. This condition, as T is well known, it ensures that, for instance, the fibers of a submersion are submanifolds of the domain definition. Under this condition, in particular, ensures that the set of composable pairs is really a submanifold of this direct product. And so it makes sense to speak about smoothness of the multiplication map. And moreover, and it will happen, this will be the typical situation by Banach manifold, again, as for instance in the book by Bourbaki, we understand a Banach manifold for which the various connected components have differing model spaces. So typically our Banach manifolds, I mean, the interesting ones will not be connected. And the, like the dimension of the connected components is different from one component to another one. Of course, in the case when the set of objects is only one, we have only one unit element, then this case corresponds to the groups. So a group should be sort of like, in this way, like a set of arrows that go on the loops corresponding to the unit. And what is important for us is that every Feynman algebra contains a Banach-Lie groupoid. This is a Banach-Lie groupoid that was studied systematically by in papers by Aneta Sligievska and Anatolodjevich. And I will, I guess Aneta will speak much better than me later today about it. So I will just briefly mention it for the purposes of this presentation. Its elements or the arrows are the partial isometries. As I said before, partial isometry is like an isometry between closed subspaces. And the closed subspaces are, of course, the objects. More formally, the set of arrows is the set of partial isometries. So they were defined by this condition, you see, and the set of objects is a set of projections. So we defined it actually in the way that it's their source and target belong to the set of objects. And then the corresponding two operators are just the source and the target. We have natural maps from the set of partial isometries to the projections. The inverse map is given by the adjoint. As I said at the beginning, before in the first lecture, the adjoint of a unitary operator is always its inverse. So, and therefore we define the adjoint as the inverse, or the inverse as the adjoint. And the multiplication in this groupoid is exactly the operator multiplication. We just compose two operators, the usual product. And moreover, this is a Banach-Lie groupoid. Again, exactly here, if we think, for instance, at the infinite, at the finite dimensional case, when M is the set of all matrices of some square matrices of some size, then the projections correspond actually to the, I mean, the connected components of the projection lattice correspond to the connected components of the Grassmann manifold correspond of that dimension. So naturally they have differing dimensions. Of course, this is not a trivial fact, but one can prove that it is true. I mean, the various axioms, smoothness axioms and so on are satisfied. Not in the language of groupoids, but many of these properties were actually studied by in the PhD thesis of Adrian Duadi, so in the mid-60s, but of course without any connection with groupoids, which were probably not very popular at that time. The importance of this groupoid, or one of the reasons it is very important, is that it acts, it has natural actions on various sets related to the Feynman algebra. In order to define in general, in order, if we have a groupoid, if we wish to define the notion of groupoid action, so action of this groupoid on some set, we need a mapping from that set into the space of units of our groupoid. I will explain here the example that is crucial for the present lecture. But before that, let me mention that there are several sets that carry such a natural so-called momentum map. For instance, besides this set of positive functionals in the pre-dual, there is also the set of, for instance, normal operators in the Feynman algebra, that is, the elements that commute with their own adjoint. And this, the study of the action of the groupoid on the set of normal operators turns out also to be very interesting, and this is actually a part of ongoing project of Gabriel Larotonda and myself. And here we will be interested in the action of the groupoid on the pre-dual. So as I mentioned here, in order to define the action of this groupoid on the pre-dual, we need a mapping from the pre-dual into the projections. And this is actually the well-known in Feynman algebra theory. It is called the support of a functional. By definition, for every positive functional, its support is the smallest projection satisfying this property. One thinks in the following way: whenever we cut an element, we cut by a projection, and we apply this functional to the result of the cutting, we obtain the same value. In the commutative case, when M from Neumann algebra consists of the essentially bounded equivalence classes of essentially bounded functions on some measure space, examples of positive functionals are given by finite measures on that space. Integration with respect to finite measures gives positive functionals. And then the support of such a functional is exactly the notion of support of a measure. So what is written here is actually the non-commutative generalization of the notion of support of a measure. And one often thinks that the Feynman algebra theory is a non-commutative measure theory. So this is a very basic piece in this direction. So now we get a map from our positive cone in the pre-dual into the projections. And using this map, we have this groupoid, the map taking values as we need it. And then we can define the set of composable pairs between an element, an arrow in the groupoid, and the point of the space on which we wish to act. So the set of composable pairs is like this, is the set of arrows whose initial space is equal to the momentum of a functional. So it's like U is an isometry on a certain subspace, and that subspace corresponds exactly to the support of our functional. And then we move the functional into the image of our arrow. So in order to move a functional through an arrow, we need the support of this functional to agree to be equal to the initial subspace of that arrow. And then we can move it, like in the case of unitary groups. this is actually can be defined in general for any groupoid and any set with a momentum map into its space of units. A groupoid action is actually a mapping defined on this corresponding set of composable pairs, and the mapping from that to the set itself. Of course, a mapping that satisfies the usual replacement of the associativity, like if we apply first an element in the groupoid and then to the result we apply another element, then the result should be the same as first multiplying the two elements in the groupoid and then applying them to the point in the space. But this axiom is obvious in this setting and comes from associativity of the multiplication in our algebra. So we don't need to, I mean, we should check it, but it's obvious. So So I didn't mention it here. In any case, so this is the groupoid, the mapping a groupoid action. And now again, as in general, whenever we have an action of a groupoid on a set, we can define a new groupoid, which is the action groupoid. Like whenever we have an action of a group on a set, this defines an action groupoid whose initial whose source map is the set of anyway I will I mean we describe the action of passing from a point to another point via that group action. So when using this mapping here on the defined on this set, we define the action groupoid. The action groupoid has the following: the total space is a set of composable pairs. The object inclusion map is the map that takes an element from our space into the pair, composable pair consisting of firstly the support of our functional. The support is a projection, but as I said before, every projection is a partial isometry. So the first component belongs here. And the second is the map itself. The source is of such a pair is just the functional we start from. But the target is the result of the action. So it's just a way to describe in a groupoid language this mapping here. Now, if we solve the equation that gives the groupoid action, we obtain the inverse map given by this formula. So for every set of in this, so for every pair in this set, we obtain another pair in the same set. Instead of U, we have the groupoid inverse, and here we have the result of the groupoid action. And for every two pairs in this set, if they are composable in this action groupoid, then which means this S star agrees with T star, then we define them by just multiplying the arrows. So as we see, what is important here is to have the groupoid of partial isometries and its action on the positive cone. And from this groupoid action, we construct an action groupoid. And in this setting, the action groupoid defined here has the following properties. Firstly, it is really a Banach-Lie groupoid. What we did here is just define the structural maps, but of course we should check the various axioms to be satisfied by the structural maps of a groupoid. Moreover, it carries this structure of Banach manifold on the space of arrows and on the space of unit. And instead of going into the details, which are too technical for this purpose of this lecture, let me just mention how we let me sketch how we build this groupoid, this Banach manifold structure. As any groupoid, this one also splits as a direct sum of its transitive subgroupoids. So we will define a topology on it so that its transitive subgroupoid should be open groupoid. In other words, we define actually the structure on every transitive subgroupoid, and then we take the direct sum of topologies and manifold structures and so on. Now, for every transitive groupoid, it comes in a natural way from a principal bundle. So there is a natural correspondence well known in the finite dimensional case between transitive Lie groupoids and principal bundles. And here, actually, we do the same. We identify certain candidate of principal bundle modeled on Banach spaces. And then we prove that the construction that works in finite dimensions also works in infinite dimensions and allows us to endow every transitive subgroupoid of this one the structure of Banachli groupoid. And this is what we are doing, what I am stating here. Moreover, we can say something about the orbits of this the corresponding Lie groupoid. Every orbit is actually the base of a transitive subgroupoid. So every orbit is actually a weakly symplectic Banach manifold. You see, if this is it should be U. So U is equal to V in this expression. So you see, if U were a unitary element instead of positive of a partial isometry, this would be the analog of a quadjoint orbit. But we have more, we have something bigger than the quadjoint orbit. We have a groupoid orbit, and therefore we need to do something more in order to endow it with a natural symplectic structure, but it's a weakly symplectic Banach manifold. This is the first indication that this action groupoid does carry some interesting Poisson geometric structures. So its base its orbits are weakly symplectic manifolds, and I remind you that in the second lecture we endowed the self-adjoint the Hermitian part of the pre-dual with a Poisson structure. So we have like a symplectic manifold contained in a or embedded into a Poisson manifold. So again, a typical thing that happens in Poisson geometry. And now we will go further and actually show that even the total space has an interesting Poisson geometric structure. So in order to get closer to the notion of presymplectic groupoid, we need the symplectic structure on the total space, which should be in a way compatible with the groupoid multiplication. And moreover, the target and source map should be to make the corresponding Poisson bracket compatible with the Poisson bracket on the base. Then the base should be a Poisson manifold. And we will see to what extent we can recover such structures in infinite dimensions. So M, H, J, and T are at the beginning. So M is the phoneme algebra of operators on the Hilbert space. J is the conjugation on H, and P is the positive cone on H. And the assertion is that there exists a groupoid structure whose total space is the Hilbert space, whose base is the positive cone in the pre-dual, such that the source map is the expectation map. You see here, I'm just summarizing the structures at the beginning, except that I'm saying that all of them fit together in the groupoid structure. So the source map was the mapping that quadratic mapping that associated to a vector, a functional on the algebra. So for every vector gamma, we form the expression that maps an operator x to gamma scalar product with x gamma. That was the functional from H to function from H to M star plus. And now we are saying it can be interpreted as the source map of a certain groupoid. The inversion map is this conjugation. It is from H to H and it's involutive. So it makes sense to suspect that it should be an inversion map. The target map, as in any groupoid, if we know the inversion on the source, we obtain the target as the composition of the source and inversion. This means that if we know the sources of the arrows, and we know how to invert them, then we can obtain the targets by just taking the source of the inverted arrow. The object inclusion map turns out to be the inverse of the Hagerup homomorphism. If you remember, the Hagerup said that the expectation map restricted to the positive cone was a homomorphism onto M star plus, and we are saying okay, so its inverse exists, and this inverse is just an inclusion map of the positive cone into the Hilbert space. This is the object inclusion map. What is interesting here, and this was a key point in what we, when we tried to figure out what happens, was that what is a key point is that you see the object inclusion map is no longer an inclusion map. It is injective, of course, but is not M star plus, is not a subset of H. We do have an injective map, but it's not a subset inclusion map. And the multiplication is defined in terms of the partial of the polar decomposition of vectors. So if we have two, we take two vectors in the Hilbert space, we consider the corresponding polar decomposition, and then we multiply the partial isometries in the polar decomposition, and we apply them to the positive part of the second operator. This product here, V sub gamma 2, applied to modulus of gamma 2, this is just gamma 2. This is the polar decomposition of gamma 2. And this is really a polar decomposition. In particular, this product here is a partial isometry if we have this composability condition. So the two vectors should satisfy this condition. Source and target are given by these formulas. And then if we make this new vector, it will be a polar decomposition of a certain vector, which is the product in our groupoid. So once again, I'm not telling here, I'm not introducing any new object, but I'm just saying that all the structures from a standard form fit together in a groupoid structure. As a simple example, in the case when n is commutative, then we wish to show, we wish to see what is the corresponding groupoid. The standard form of, I mean, any commutative algebra, Neumann algebra is L infinity on some measure space. So there exists a measure space such that the predual of the algebra is the Banach space of absolutely integrable functions on that measure space. Our algebra is the space of bounded functions. Of course, the positive cone is just a set of positive integrable functions. And what is the standard representation? We need a Hilbert space, which is the square integrable functions on T. The positive cone is what we expect, the positive square integrable functions. The source and target should go from L2, L1 plus, and the natural map to go from square integrable functions to positive integrable functions is take the square root, or the square modulus of the modulus. And then the standard representation is the representation by multiplication operator that we discussed before. So L infinity of T and mu is faithfully represented as the algebra of multiplication operators on this L2. And the conjugation on this Hilbert space is just the point-wise conjugation. And moreover, if we do this operation JMJ to such a multiplication operator, means that we map a multiplication operator by F to a multiplication operator by F bar, but that is also bounded. So it just maps the algebra to itself, to its commutant. It should map to its commutant, but the commutant is equal to the algebra itself. So as we see quite a few structures, basic structures in measure theory, again, fit together in a groupoid structure. This groupoid is actually a group bundle because its source and target maps are equal. So actually in the picture of a groupoid as a set of arrows, we have no arrows between distinct points. Every data is a set of loops. And we see why this mapping object inclusion. Yes, the object inclusion map is also. I think I forgot to. It should go from L1 of T plus. Yes, I forgot to put it. In order to go from L1 of T, from this space to this, you see, from this to this, we should take the square root. So if we take, if we have a function, a positive integrable function, if we take its square root, the square root will be square integrable. So this object inclusion map is just taking square root of a positive function. Of course, it would be too much to express the measure theory in terms of groupoids, but I am just saying that in one of the simplest cases, this theorem really encodes many basic ingredients of the measure theory. And we will see actually even non-commutative examples later. Now we will see that actually this the groupoid we construct here is isomorphic to the groupoid we constructed before. Let us just note that we are saying nothing about smooth structures here. This is just a groupoid. I'm not saying it's a Lie groupoid. But the Lie structure comes from the fact that it is isomorphic to the Banach-Lie groupoid constructed before. Namely, the expectation map allows us to define a bijection. So the total space of this groupoid is the Hilbert space, H. And then we must define a bijection from the Hilbert space to this set of composable pairs. And it's quite natural. We take a vector, decompose it, consider its polar decomposition, and then we form the pair consisting of the partial isometry and the expectation of the modulus. And then we obtain a pair here. And the theorem that is stated here is that this mapping is a bijection. And moreover, it is a groupoid isomorphism. You see, we have two groupoids, this defined right here and this from the previous page. And they have the same basis. We just need a bijection from between the set of arrows, and it is here. And this is really respects all the groupoid mappings. So it is a groupoid isomorphism. We should also discuss what happens on the level of, on the smooth level. This groupoid constructed above has no natural smooth structure except that its total space is a Hilbert space. So it makes sense to ask about the smoothness properties of this mapping. This was a Banach manifold. We organized it as a Banach manifold. And it turns out that this bijection is the weak immersion of Banach manifolds, except that it should go in the opposite direction. I mean, the inverse of this bijection is the weak immersion. So it's like this, I said this was a disjoint union of Banach manifolds, and this is the Hilbert space. This is like a weak immersion, is like a foliation of this Hilbert space, but the leaves of the foliation are Banach manifolds. So they are, of course, immersed, some manifolds, not embedded some manifolds. But in a way, we enrich the original smooth structure of the Hilbert space into a foliation-like structure. And with this enriched structure, this new groupoid is also a Banach-Lie groupoid. So we can, once we, our groupoid is also, even this one is a Lie groupoid with this new structure. Or we can think like this, we transport, we use this bijection to transport the smooth structure of this to this, but since this total space already has a smooth structure, it makes sense to ask about the relation between the two. And I said this, the relation is like a foliation relation between a foliation on a Banach manifold and the original smooth structure of that manifold. So far we have another Banachli groupoid. I mean, it's only one, but because they are isomorphic. And now we can look at the corresponding Poisson structures. For this, I recall that we had a mapping from the skew adjoint elements into the smooth functions on the pre-dual, which was an anti-morphism of the algebras with respect to the Lipoisson bracket. And this is just in order to show you that the basis of our groupoid is a subset of a Poisson manifold. And now we have the following additional structures. The source and target maps from the Hilbert space to this Hermitian part of the pre-dual are Poisson, respectively, anti-Poisson maps, meaning that they map, they respect the Poisson bracket here, or they reverse the sign. So H, what is the Poisson bracket for functions on the Hilbert space? The Hilbert space carries a strongly symplectic structure by just the imaginary part of the scalar product. This is strongly symplectic, so one can define the Poisson bracket for any two functions, since any function has a smooth function has a Hamiltonian vector field. We don't have the problem that I mentioned in the last lecture. And the source and target show that this preserves these two Poisson brackets. Moreover, we have this symplectic structure on our Hilbert space. Remember that we consider the kind of foliation of this Hilbert space. So when we restrict that symplectic structure to every leaf, we still get a closed form, but of course it will be in principle degenerate. What we are saying is that this closed degenerate form is multiplicative in the sense of groupoid theory. That is, it satisfies this condition, which is equivalent to the fact that the graph of the multiplication map is an isotropic submanifold for suitable pre-symplectic manifold. So in any case, this is the natural notion of multiplicativity. It is also related to the fact that the multiplication map should be a Poisson map between suitable Poisson structures. And moreover, since it is degenerate, it makes sense to ask about its degeneracy. And we can describe the leaves corresponding to the null foliation of this. That is, at every point, we consider all the vectors that are orthogonal to the whole space. And this will form a distribution, vector distribution, and the corresponding leaves. It is integrable, and the corresponding leaves are can be described exactly as the fibers of this submotion. And moreover, every groupoid orbit in the base has a weakly symplectic structure, which moreover can be obtained from this presymplectic form by a kind of reduction procedure. So it is a closed degenerate form. We kind of cut out the degeneracy, and when we project down, we obtain the weakly symplectic form on the groupoid orbits. So this is you see ever so many structures from presymplectic groupoids show up in this setting in a rather coherent way. And maybe finally, I will consider another example of L-infinite, a non-commutative example of the simplest von Neumann algebra, namely the von Neumann algebra of bounded operators on some Hilbert space. As I said before, this is not a standard von Neumann algebra, but it does have a standard form. So we represent it faithfully in a standard form on another Hilbert space. What is that other Hilbert space? It is so-called the space of Hilbert-Schmidt operators. This is the Hilbert space with respect to this norm. It carries a natural conjugation given by the operator adjoint has a natural cone, the positive cone, and also has a representation of our initial algebra by multiplication operators. If you remember what we did for matrices, it's just the same construction, except that in the case of matrices, we don't need to impose this condition, it is satisfied always. And then this is the standard form of a standard form of this algebra. And what is its corresponding groupoid? Corresponding groupoid has its total space, a Hilbert space, this standard Hilbert space L2. The base is the positive cone in L1, so positive operator in L1. The source and target maps are given by the source of an operator is gamma star gamma. Target is gamma gamma star. You see, this involves really the range of the operator gamma. And the multiplication is defined in terms of the polar decomposition of operators, as I have shown before in the first lecture, the polar decomposition of operators is compatible with the special case of this polar decomposition obtained by Hager. And the orbit of an operator is just a kind of unitary orbit, except that we consider the action by partial isometries whose initial space is the closure of the range of our operator. I wouldn't like to take too much of your time, so I think I'll stop here. What still can be done, but this is can be found in the paper by Anatol Odjevic and myself, is we have shown how some properties of Neumann algebras are reflected by these groupoids, or in other words, how they are translated. For instance, just this basic notion of finiteness of Neumann algebra, which requires that every isometry is unitary, like in the case of matrices. This condition is satisfied if and only if the orbits of this corresponding standard groupoid are connected. And this kind of properties are can be found for some other special types of Neumann algebras. There is another type called purely infinite, in which any two projections are equivalent to each other, so like all of them are have infinite dimension. And this condition is equivalent to the fact that every orbit of the groupoid has exactly two connected components, namely zero and the other ones, and so on. So, but these are just translations of the definitions in the groupoid language. Interesting, but of course one should to be even more interesting to see in more detail how what is known from the classification of Neumann algebras if it can be translated into the groupoid language. And I will stop here. Thanks for following me.
Yes, yeah, all right. Thank you, Daniel, for this very nice lecture. So are there any questions? Oh, there's one question in the room.
Thank you, Daniel. I would like to understand a bit more the notion of momentum map in this context. Can you go back perhaps and make the link with the notion of momentum map that we know?
I didn't go too much. Why we call it a momentum map? We call it a momentum map since in this setting we expect the base to be a Poisson manifold. And since it takes, usually if we have an action of a group on a symplectic manifold, the momentum map is defined on that manifold with values into the dual of the Lie algebra of the group. And the dual of the Lie algebra is a Lie Poisson space. Well, here, so for the reason that one defines the momentum maps with as maps with values into a Poisson manifold and into a Lie Poisson space, but also in more general Poisson manifolds. For this reason, some people call it a momentum map. But one shouldn't think about things like convexity properties and so on, just because it is just because we expect our groupoids to reflect a kind of Poisson geometric structures, and therefore their base should carry some kind of Poisson, what should be like a phantom of a Poisson manifold. But this is the only reason why we call it a momentum map.
But can we get a momentum map in the classical setting for some examples, or?
We cannot recover in the classical case. The momentum map takes values into the dual of a Lie algebra, while this set of projections is never the dual of a Lie algebra. We cannot recover, but some people in the general theory of groupoid actions call the corresponding map as a momentum map. This is why I use this, but I use the quotation marks for this reason. We cannot recover any classical momentum map.
Okay. Thank you very much.
There is a question from Peter Mikor.
Thank you. I have a very vague question. I have heard a lecture by Jörg Fröhlich, where he developed a version of quantum mechanics where he used partial isometries instead of unitary operators. And you know that in quantum mechanics, since every evolution operator is unitary, means no information can be lost, which leads to this question, what happens with black holes? Because how do you get information back out of black holes? So maybe these partial isometries and these projection operators that one has could lead to a version of quantum mechanics where really information is lost in the black holes. So maybe this could be a basis of some, yes, speculation in that direction.
Yes, I was not aware. Jörg Fröhlich, you said it, the author?
Yes.
Yes, I should look it up. No, I was not aware of this. It is possible. I mean, one could speculate that the infinite projections could contain an infinite loss of information. But of course, one should... it's a very interesting potential application, yes.
Thank you.
Any more questions? Marco has a question. Thank you. So I have two questions. So the first one is about the groupoid you presented the very end. I guess it's on this slide here. So it carries two kinds of geometric structures, right? So there's the space of errors. It's this H tilde. It has both a Poisson structure and a presymplectic two form, right? Yes.
Yes.
And the same, well, something similar holds for the orbits on the base, right? You said so the orbits have a weak symplectic structure, but they also sit inside the Poisson manifold. So should I think of these two structures, the two form and the Poisson structure, as being like morally the same thing? Like if we were in infinite dimension, you would have only one object, but since we're in infinite dimensions, you cannot make such a nice statement.
You mean about the relation between the symplectic form here and the symplectic form in the orbit?
Okay.
I see you ask about the inclusion map with this what is the relation between.
For instance, that O carries a weak symplectic structure, but it also sits in a Poisson manifold.
Yes, here when we say that the inclusion is a Poisson map, it says that the Poisson brackets are compatible. They should be thought of as the same. So okay. This is the relation. The Poisson bracket of the associated to this weakly symplectic form is compatible with the Poisson bracket from the space. Yes.
Thank you. And the second question, well, it's very vague, I guess. So you said that by writing down this groupoid, you can translate some properties of the Feynman algebra into groupoid language. And so can this point of view be, you know, used to get new statements about Feynman algebras, or at least to get some intuition or, I don't know, inspiration or something?
Yes, of course, this would be the ideal, but these are very basic properties, you see, that finiteness and purely infiniteness. And there is another thing called the type 3 occur in a family of classes parameterized by a certain lambda in the interval 0 and 1. And type 3 0 is a type of algebra that show up in quantum field theory. That can also be expressed like this, but this is just a pure translation. For instance, the Mare-Von-Neumann equivalence classes correspond to the groupoid orbits, this kind of thing. But of course, one should try to do that. But I don't know what to predict in this direction.
All right, any more questions?
There is a question from Joel.
Hi. So I wanted to, you mentioned this, the case of the group von Neumann algebra for like a countable group. And I was curious if you could, is there like any interesting relationship that you can make between like the group structure and like this groupoid, like how they're like.
Countable discrete groups, you mean? All these, the algebras corresponding to countable discrete groups, they are finite in this. So they are finite, and this is what we can say at once. But as regards the, maybe you know, there is this theory of rigidity, namely to what extent if the Feynman algebras are isomorphic, then the groups itself, themselves are isomorphic. So this is a quite a difficult theory, but of course the previous question was related to what you are asking. So to what extent we can reflect to what extent the classification of Feynman algebras can be reflected by the groupoids. Yes, this would be very interesting, but I think it would be quite difficult. But anyway, this theory is at its very beginning, so one should not be too pessimistic about it.
Any more questions? If not, let's thank Daniel again for this very nice mini course.